Sandra Steingraber. She's been called one of the 25 visionaries who are changing your world. This is part two of our two-part interview, next on Enviro Close-Up. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman. Let's focus now on how you, Sandra, have combined your research and writings with direct action, challenging the entities that have made and are making such a mess of the planet and even going to jail in doing so.
Sure. So I live now in upstate New York, and around 2009, I discovered, along with all of my neighbors, about the same time, that the bedrock under our feet is an ancient ocean floor that contains a lot of fossilized corpses of animals that lived 400 million years ago in the Devonian era. And they had fossilized into tiny bubbles of methane that were wholly trapped inside as a kind of fizz of petrified champagne bubbles inside this bedrock a mile below our feet. And furthermore, that the gas companies and the oil companies had figured out a way through horizontal hydraulic fracturing to liberate what had formerly been unattainable fossil fuels. And they were going to do this by using drinking water as the club to smash the bedrock apart and release these tiny bubbles. And they had already leased up the land very quietly, had gotten permission from landowners in the county that I live in. 40% of the land, all the acreage was already leased to the gas industry before we kind of woke up to all this, including parcels right at the end of my block. My son has asthma. I knew enough about what went on in that process, the benzene that was released, the radioactivity that comes out of the ground with the gas, to be very distressed as a public health biologist and as a mother. And so I, you know, joined forces with a lot of other people, some also health professionals, some attorneys, some faith leaders, to decide, again, that we were not interested in trying to come up with best industrial practices or a best way to regulate this, especially when it seemed that to us that no regulatory framework could make this safe, that was inherently dangerous, just like smoking on an airplane. There's nothing you can do to make that safe. You can't put the smokers in the back and protect anyone. And so we didn't want to take a let's smoke in the back of the plane approach to fracking. We just wanted there to be no fracking. And that's what we asked for. And then we began to organize politically. So happily, my own contribution to that work was assisted when I received this Heinz Award in 2011, and it came with a cash prize. So I donated that check to found, along with a couple of other organizations, to found a coalition of groups called New Yorkers Against Fracking, which when we started was a group of like six of us. And when we finally did ban fracking in December 2014, we were now more than 500 groups. And some of those groups were themselves coalitions, right? Like we had more than 1,000 business leaders, 500 churches and synagogues and so on. And so we didn't need to deploy civil disobedience to ban fracking. What we did need to do was to keep bringing the science out of the obscurity of the peer-reviewed literature and laying it before our elected officials, before our health commissioner, but also before the citizenry itself. You know, I spent the better part of 2 years going around to church basements and rotary clubs and public libraries and junior high school auditoriums and town hall meetings, just describing together with other scientists what we knew about the risks and harms of fracking. And when we started that work in around 2011, there were 60 studies in the peer-reviewed literature. And when we finally banned fracking in 3 years later, in December 2014, there were more than 500 studies. So we were speaking in a moving stream of data. But by animating the citizenry with knowledge and science, we really move the needle of public opinion. So I didn't go to jail for that. But along with fracking came infrastructure issues. including pipelines and compressor stations and flare stacks and the need to actually store the gas somewhere. And so where I live, which is on a little rumply strip of land in between two of New York's Finger Lakes, Cayuga Lake being to my east and Seneca Lake being to my west, the plan then was that we would store a lot of the fracked gas from out-of-state fracking operations in these crumbling salt mines underneath the bank of Seneca Lake. And then we would put it in pipelines with a lot of compressor stations and flare stacks and send it east to East Coast markets. And our efforts to ban that replicated our efforts to ban fracking. So I was working kind of on both projects for a while, where a lot of us health professionals kept submitting data along with the geologists about the inherent dangers of underground storage of gas. We had examples of other places where this all ended up disastrously. Terrible for the climate because it leaks methane for sure, can't make it not leak. Puts a source of drinking water for 100,000 people at risk. We said all these things, and nevertheless, approval for the project happened anyway. And it was a decision by an agency called the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, which is in Washington. And so that's when we decided that civil disobedience would be our next step. Because I think you have a decision to make when you have redress of grievance and you bring all kinds of science to bear, and then the decider says, oh, we're just not looking at that science. We're going to look at what industry claims and said. So you have your risk analysis, but the industry says they have their own risk analysis, and they've left out all the stuff that you included, but we're going to go with theirs. So then I think the decision, as somebody who's a scientist in the public interest, is like, well, do I stop here and just say, well, I did the best I could? But I'm more than just, a scientist, right? I live here. My son Elijah was born on the banks of that lake. He goes to camp in a state park where all of those explosive gases are going to be transported on a rickety old train trestle. And so I felt I couldn't just stop there, that if I needed to take my mother's body and stand in the driveway in between the truck and the well and the place they're going to store the gas, then that's what I would do. And so I became a civil disobedient. It was a very new experience for me. And I did it twice. And in both cases, I received from the local judge the full, the maximum sentence for trespass, which a violation of trespass in New York will get you 15 days in the county jail. And what I learned through that experience is that even though by temperament, I'm not a kind of a confrontational person, I'm actually really good at going to jail. And it turns out I'm good at it. I have this whole skill set I didn't know I had because I'm really good at being a cancer patient. I really know how to kind of keep my head in inherently stressful, extreme situations. Being in a small space doesn't bother me. In jail you have crappy food, the lights are on all night, the television is blaring. It's the same in a hospital. The difference is in a hospital you have a call button, but they never answer the call button in a hospital anyway, right? So for me, exchanging the backless blue cotton gown for an orange jumpsuit was a kind of a lateral move. I wasn't sedated. I wasn't in pain. I was just in a cell. It was actually fairly relaxing for me because I got to read and write in sustained ways and just really think long thoughts. Martin Luther King Jr. talks about this too. You don't have a chance to do that in the outside world. So I realized this is something I could contribute. I'm not afraid of jail, right? I'm far more afraid of my next MRI than I am a jail cell. And I think there's a certain power in knowing that about yourself. It has given me a certain kind of fearlessness in going forward. So as we begin to see now around the world, this emergent civil disobedience movement, it's just breaking out everywhere. As people are sitting down in front of oil trains, at a time when we have this international treaty, the Paris Accord, that tells us that the plan is supposed to be we're getting off of fossils altogether by the middle of the century. And people know that's the plan, that's what science says has to be the plan, and yet when people go home to their home communities, what they see are continuous fossil fuel build out anyway. It's like this zombie industry that just keeps on going and keeps building pipelines and keeps wanting to put our communities at risk to store the stuff and burn the stuff and new power plants. And so people are realizing that it's up to us. Our governments are held hostage by this industry. And so we need to deploy this time-honored practice of civil disobedience, which after all helped India throw off the whole British Empire, which is the driver of throwing off apartheid in South Africa and so forth, that we can repurpose this tactic. And that's what we're seeing all around the world. And so I'm really pleased that I'm able to participate in that as a mother, as a biologist, and as a cancer patient. It feels like kind of all parts of my life are in alignment in the moment where I'm participating in civil disobedience and helping other people sort of dare themselves into doing that as well.
As Rachel Carson was a biologist, she was trained in science. You too, Sandra, are a full-fledged scientist with a degree in biology from the University of Michigan. What do you think about scientists, and I don't like to generalize, but the stance of many scientists on these issues? Have scientists been independent enough, or have some been captured by self-interest?
Well, I don't think scientists are so much captured as I think that they are muted by the culture of science itself and what's sort of normative practice for science. And that is that, you know, scientists are, like, to be a professional scientist means to speak about the data and then stop. And that the assumption is it's somebody else's job, after we're done analyzing our data, to take that data, if it's about public health, if it's about climate and the environment, it's somebody else's job to take that data into the halls of power to our elected officials and say, you know what, our laws and our policy are not in alignment with what the evidence tells us. But it turns out it's nobody's job to do that. It's really up to us, the scientists, to be the voice for that. Carson realized that as long ago as, you know, in the middle of the McCarthy era. And she was really frustrated when she was putting her book together, which is a little bit like assembling a big jigsaw puzzle, right? So she had all this data that she knew her colleagues in the federal government, especially in Fish and Wildlife, she knew that they had data that the public had not been able to look at. And there were these fierce debates about pesticide use and what it was doing to people, what it was doing to birds. They were raging in the hidden worlds of science and also in these federal agencies, and nobody was telling the populace. So she set out to do that, and she was assisted by the fact that there was a lawsuit that was wending its way up to the Supreme Court that started in Long Island having to do with aerial DDT spraying. And so that sort of the power of attorney and the discovery that lawsuit allowed gave her access to data. So she turned then to her colleagues in the sciences, asking them to share data with her and to speak out with her, and they wouldn't do it. And she was very frustrated in her private writings, as she expressed to her friend Dorothy, that she had no respect for these guys who knew but refused to speak out. In fact, she thought she was quoting Abraham Lincoln. It turned out Lincoln never said this, but it's a very fine quote anyway. She said, "To sin by silence when they should protest makes cowards out of men." And she was, by men, she really meant men, not just generic people. She thought there was something about men that caused them to stop. And it really, that she as a woman scientist was not going to stop, that she was going to do more than just publish data. She was going to be a gladiator for that data and bring it into the halls of power and make sure that, you know, she called for the EPA, something in the executive branch of our government that would not be corrupted by Congress, but under the direct direction of the president to deal with this issue. That's what she wanted. That's what she testified for at the end of her life, even though she was hiding her whole cancer diagnosis at the time. And so that's the kind of model that I've chosen for myself. I, like all scientists, take great pride in my objectivity, meaning if you show me a bunch of data, I can suspend all my feelings and thoughts about how I think the world should be and just let the data talk to me and analyze it and see what it says. But at the end of the day, if it looks like people are dying or being hurt, or that we, you know, our climate is going to collapse in such a way that we can't practice agriculture anymore, then I'm still objective, but I'm no longer neutral. You know, once the data analysis is done, then like I just become a citizen again, like anyone else. I have a duty as a citizen to prevent people from being harmed. And I have a duty as a citizen to make sure my government does what it's tasked with doing, which is to look out for domestic tranquility and ensure security and take care of us if we can't take care of ourselves, whether it's, you know, a terrorist threat or somebody putting stuff in the drinking water. That's what the government is supposed to do. And as citizens, we all have responsibility to make sure our government's doing what it's supposed to do. So so I'm willing to fight really hard about that. And I also assert that my willingness to do that and even go to jail has nothing to do with my ability to analyze data. But my ability to analyze data may give me reasons for why I think people need to fill the jails at this point. And I know that that's not a majority view, but it's a view that I think more and more scientists are reaching on their own as they come to the recognition that if we don't do this, no one else is going to do it. There is truly sort of nobody who's just monitoring the birth defect registries or the cancer registries or the atmospheric chemistry data, and then making sure that our laws are in alignment with what the data show. We just have to carry that ourselves. And so I think what we need then is for scientists to exercise their own skills as citizens, knowing how and being willing to talk to the press, being willing to give expert testimony, go into a hearing and give public comments, all these things that we kind of squirrely, a little bit shy, antisocial scientists are not comfortable doing usually. But there are certain historical moments where you just kind of have to get over yourself and go against your own personality, I think, and do what needs to be done. That's a lesson I really learned from my dad, you know, who was a teenage combatant in World War II, that if you find yourself in a situation where there's this overwhelming horrible thing happening, no matter what kind of person you are, you're going to have to engage with this. You can't turn away from it. I think science is an incredible privilege, and so we use that privilege and turn it into a strength and turn it into political power. I saw that in spades in Paris when the climate treaty was being negotiated, and certain forces at work, some of them nation states, some of them corporations, were eager to water down this treaty and scuttle it and make it less powerful than it needed to be. And happily, the better angels prevailed, and we actually have a strong treaty, but it required different groups of people speaking truth to power and making really strong ethical arguments. In some cases, they were the indigenous peoples of the world. In other cases, they were a coalition of island nations who made a very powerful case that if you water this treaty down, we will drown. And we were not willing to be the human sacrifices for a failed policy. But also, the world's climate scientists at one point just flew in and held a press conference and made a very powerful statement. And I was so thrilled with that, because I just felt like I was seeing my brothers and sisters in science exercising their political voices, and that's exactly what science should do. If science is a servant of the public good, then it has to go out there and serve. And that's the kind of model that Carson gave to us, I think, in her own quiet way, that a lot of us are trying to kind of labor in the vineyard, in the vineyards that she planted, if you will.
Sandra, you wrote an article for Orion magazine titled Mind Games, in which you speak about the human right to a toxic-free environment.
So that essay came straight out of Raising Elijah, and it looks at the evidence for toxic chemical exposure on child development of the brain, and looks at certain endpoints such as autism, learning disabilities, attention deficit disorder, looks at lead poisoning, mercury poisoning, PCBs, and so on, and argues that that we all have the right to have our minds develop within an environment that does not sabotage the wiring together of our brains and diminish our human potential. So it is an essay in which I make a human rights argument together with a neurological case, a neurological argument.
The young people you teach as a professor, what about them and these issues?
Well, I feel that a lot of the problems that we're now handing off to the next generation, which of course includes my own two children, really happened on my watch, right? So I was born in 1959, and in that year, we had a stable climate. You could still eat fish from the surface waterways in the Midwest, and now you can't do any of those things. So within, you know, my lifetime of almost 57 years, all these things changed. So as far as I can see, as a member of my generation, I have a duty and a responsibility to spend the 20 years, you know, between 57 and 77. Those years are completely dedicated to me, to fighting the fossil fuel industry and fighting climate change. That's what I'm going to do. And of course, the generation of my kids and other younger kids who are inheriting this, they also have certain kinds of responsibilities. But the burden of all this falls more heavily on them because more of their life is going to be lived under this kind of new, chaotic, crisis-driven ecological system that we have. But I'm actually less focused on what they're going to do than what I can do in the next 20 years. And I intend to fight as hard as I can. And I think the nice thing about getting older is you can kind of look really difficult problems square in the face and not get thrown off by them and figure out how you're going to move forward with this. I have a kind of a perspective and a little more ballast, I guess, than I did when I was in my 20s. So I guess I'm more interested in figuring out how I can work in concert with other people now, within and without the scientific community, to make the system move. But because I'm in the academy and I'm around a lot of young people, I do try to convey and signal that I live a really meaningful life. And that, because I think a lot of people assume that if you wake up every morning and you think about climate change and cancer, that there's this really depressing way to live. But in fact, I don't feel that way. I feel really lucky in my life. First of all, because I'm a cancer survivor. And second of all, because life is a beautiful thing, even when it's tattered and frayed and ecosystems are stressed, it's a beautiful thing. And third, because when you wake up every morning and you realize that my work today is the most important thing I could be doing and is part of collective work that a lot of people all around the world are doing, that's, there's a kind of deep happiness in doing that that I don't think is, you can see from the outside. It's the opposite of feeling despair. I think the despair factor comes from doing nothing and trying to not see the problem. Whereas once you engage with it, then it's not so bad. And also because I was part of a ragtag little army that stared down the biggest industry in the world in New York State, and we won. We banned fracking in New York. And so the lesson to me is when you organize and fight as hard as you can win. And I'm really interested in continuing to do that. And I think as I do that, I hope others feel inspired to join in, just as I feel inspired by the abolitionists of old, by my father, and by the people around me who are also fighting really hard. So acts of courage, I think, breed more acts of courage. So I am really interested in that piece of it. And it's very exciting in these civil disobedience movements that you see how intergenerational they are. So the one that I'm involved with at the banks of Seneca Lake, I'm standing side by side with people who are as young as 18 and as old as 93. And they all bring their own autobiographies and their own life experiences to that moment.
Why do government regulators, do you believe, routinely permit life-threatening technologies to persist?
Well, it is true. Our government, as other governments, can become held hostage by very powerful forces. And one of those is the fossil fuel industry. And so even though we have all the science on our side that says, you know, the time to address this was really yesterday, we're unable to move as quickly as we need to because of these very powerful interests. But that simply has fueled a kind of citizen movement where people are rising up against the fossil fuel industry, who are the kind of tyrants of our day, I would say, and insisting on climate justice. What science can do is show us the risk for harm for taking no action, and it can also show us that we have solutions to almost all of these problems, but they're really being held hostage by this powerful industry that keeps wanting to light fossils on fire. And so we're really engaged in a kind of hostage rescue mission, I would say, to try to get green chemistry and green energy deployed. And the exciting thing is that once we start, that if we can send a clear political signal that a new day has dawned and the way forward is not to look down into the bedrock for energy, but rather up into wind and sun and water for energy, then at some point, economies of scale start to ramp up, the cost of renewables start to fall, and of course, the cost of extracting oil, gas, and coal don't fall. In fact, they get more expensive because we're running out of them, and we have to do more extreme things to just extract them. And so at some point then, the financial incentives begin to tip toward renewables, and then you get a good kind of positive feedback loop where they keep getting better and better, and innovation keeps happening more and more rapidly, and the costs get cheaper and cheaper, as what happened with telecommunications. And I think the beauty of this huge problem that we have is that by having such a monumental problem that really just has one cause, which is fossil fuels, that we can all bring whatever skill sets we have to work on this problem, and we can do it in concert. We really need to play the Save the World Symphony at this point. You don't have to play a solo, but you do have to know what instrument you play, and you do have to follow along and know where we're at in the score and play as best you can in concert with everyone else. And I think that's the challenge of our age.
Thank you so much, Sandra, for being with us in Enviro Close-Up and for your extraordinary and vital work.
Thanks so much for having me, Carl. It's been a pleasure.
This has been the second part of our two-part Enviro Close-Up interview with Sandra Steingraber. For information about the Enviro Close-Up series and other programs of Enviro Video, just go to our website, envirovideo.com, and follow us on Twitter at Enviro Video. I'm Carl Grossman. Thanks for watching.